Hi, everyone. Your information speech is due this week, and I think you must have an idea now, having just done an information speech for your In the News. That was an information speech. It's when you're conveying information, encoding information to your audience, to your receivers, teaching them about something. And you've all done it, and you all did such a great job. You went from your introduction to your In the News and now information. So it is like Groundhog's Day. I'm looking for delivery. I'm looking for eye contact, good energy throughout, a clear, concise message. And for you to have I have a sense that you care about what you're speaking about. If you care, we will care. So that is the key to this entire connection with the audience, is caring and genuineness. The information speech is, as you see on the handout, it is going to cover a person, a place, a process, in other words, a noun. And it is not just limited to the In the News. However, some students like In the News, and they'll do another In the News for their information speech, and I am fine with that. But instead of 2 to 5 minutes, this time build your content 4 to 7. And I would suggest not using one article, but maybe 2 articles. So if you found yourself in the news the last few weeks and that you had to do a presentation on it, that you liked that paradigm, staying within news articles, you can do one again for your information speech. You could also do an information speech on some body of work that you've done for another class. Maybe in your psychology class last semester or astronomy class, you had to do a paper. You could take that paper, shake it out, don't read it to us, break it down into outline of notes, so you're going to be speaking extemporaneously, give some more examples, but your research is done because you know what you're talking about. You're going to talk about something in the solar system, or you're going to be talking about bipolarism, or you're going to talk about something you wrote in history class or an English class. So going back to your scholarship, it's your scholarship, you're not plagiarizing. You can see how you could have it in written communication and in oral communication. So the information speech is much broader. A straight lecture, a lecture with some visual aids, if you want to show us a chart or a graph or something like that. I'm not expecting a PowerPoint because that's a little challenging when you're trying to just do a straight video. So I'm not expecting that, but still you could have some visuals. Maybe you're going to talk to us about your new Galaxy Android phone, and you want to show us the phone and describe the different features in the phone. So that would be a visual. So you could do a visual. Maybe you want to do an information speech about the breed of dog you have, and you have your dog on your lap, and you're going to tell us the information that you want to share, teach us about your dog. Or maybe you're a yogi and you want to show us some yoga moves. So you'll put your camera down and you'll do some down dogs or something as you speak about yoga. If you're going to do a process, and students in the past have done very successful recipes, showing us how to change a tire, how to set up a camping site with a tent, you make sure what you do is that your eye contact is going to suffer. As soon as you get down into a process, you can't look at your audience and do anything with your hands. But what you do for that is you also always do your introduction looking right at your audience, introducing, say, today I'm going to show you how to make Rice Krispie treats. Welcome to my kitchen. And then you're going to look down at your Rice Krispie treats. You might show us the bag or the box of Rice Krispies, the bowl you're going to use. But then when you're going to do them, you're going to be looking down. Now, what I suggest is just like you would see with Martha Stewart or Rachel Ray or Julia Child, anyone who's going to do a cooking demonstration, all the details are done in advance. So success is in the details. So put out everything you need, the butter, the pan, the Rice Krispies, the marshmallow. And even though you're going to be doing some of it, maybe scooping, you're not going to be doing the entire demonstration. And you would already have it pre-done, the ending, and you go, voila, here we are. So you can do a process speech as long as you have organized your details out. Same with a tire. If you're going to show us how to change a flat tire, you can do that on video because you're home now, right? So what I would suggest is you look at your audience. You have all your tools, your jack, your little a wedgy thing to secure the car, whatever you use, your lug wrench, and say, these are what we're going to be using. Now I'm going to show you how to do it. And if you have someone to hold the video for you or you have a stand, then if you're not looking at your audience during the body of the speech, that's okay. Look at your audience in the beginning, do your demonstration, and then come back to your audience at the end for your lasting impression and say thank you, any questions, or recap what you just did. So you can do a demonstration, you can do a straight lecture, you can revamp or refurbish one of your old papers and do that in the oral communication, even though initially you did it written, now do it orally, using your good language, using your good energy, not reading it, but speaking to us. You're always looking at an audience, right? Not reading to us. You can read some of it as you would on your notes, but it's not a read, it's a speech. Or you can do a straight lecture with visual aids, and it can be on anything really that's legal and in good taste. So it could be in sports, it could be in medicine, it could be in exercise. You could tell us something about COVID-19 and the NFL. See, that's what I'm saying. You might go back to those newspapers to talk about anything like that. So information is broader than just the in the news. It could be something very personal that you enjoy and you like to do and you want to share with us. The next speech after this is the persuasive. Now, drawing from your English experience, you know that persuasion means to believe, and it means you're trying to convince your audience of something. In information, this week's presentation is just information for information's sake. And I know some of you have already told me that you may do it 3, 4, 5, 6 times before you send in your video. It's a lot of work doing these speeches. It really is. We don't have quizzes. We don't have a lot of heavy academics. But we do have these speeches, and they're going to take up your time. All right, I can't wait to see what you come up with. Now, I'm looking at our website right now. Make sure when you go into the week, what week is this for? Week 6? Week 6, let me see. You know, I get my weeks, life is going by way too fast. I'm going to click over here to make sure I'm in my Calm 101 class, and pretty sure it's week 6. Do-do-do-do-do. Mm-hmm. Week 6. Over here, we have a discussion board on The Danger of Silence by Clint Smith. Do the best you can responding to that. But I think if you've already watched it, you get the message. And you can discuss it, or you can tell us about a time or an observation where you did notice someone did speak up. Because oral arguments, oral communication is often lacking in our society, and that's where our power is. So you want to keep your power. But you have to speak appropriately in the appropriate setting. If you're always outspoken everywhere you go and you start arguing too much, you're never going to get, your life is never going to get on track. If you start arguing with every police officer, it may not work. But you have a legitimate complaint, hopefully you can be heard. Or if you don't have a satisfactory connection at that time, you speak up about it in the appropriate way so that you don't get hurt. Because I've annoyed some police officers in my younger days arguing about something. It's not the time or the place. But speaking up can be very emotionally healthy too. They say that so many people who don't speak up, they just swallow the negative energy and they just keep it in, and then one day they just blow up. So speaking up is healthy. It can help others too in your community, in your world, and you really need to speak up when appropriate, right? So that's important, but not to shy away. And then ethics in public speaking, huge chapter on ethics, right? We're in an ethical dilemma right now. We're watching a president who's engaging in homicidal negligence. Ethics is out the window, but that's not you. You are an ethical person and moral. All right, then it says VoiceThread post here, information presentation. That's where you're going to post it. And then the second VoiceThread is always the collective, our body of work from the beginning, from our introductions, in the news, information. So it just gets held there. So if you're looking for someone's introduction, just scroll down to the bottom and you'll see it. And then you'll see the next layer will be the in the news and now the information. But this is where we house them. So it's important to have two VoiceThreads. The first one is the one I go into where you post it, I grade it, leave a comment, and that's where it goes right to the grade book, and then it's organized for me. And that's very important to do it there. And then it just comes right down into the second voice thread for everyone to see each other's. So that's why there are two. If you've never worked with VoiceThread before, you can control them the way you want. I really want the speeches to be graded. That's why they have to have a separate one. And then it goes down into the holding tank, or the collective, as I like to call it. The glorious collective of all our good work, all our scholarship, all the supports down there too. One thing I've noticed in many of my classes, students either do leave comments or they don't leave comments. And I would encourage you to leave comments to your peers. I think it's incredibly important to acknowledge that they did a presentation, and maybe you don't know what to say. You might just say, hey, liked your speech. Just in class, I try to do the same thing. And oftentimes after a student is completed their presentation, I'll ask for any commentary. Does anyone have any questions? Of course, the speaker says the same thing. And usually there's one or two people that raise their hand and they start a dialogue, and that's public speaking. It's really good. And then I always say something. What I say is usually how I speak on the comments, right? And I've been lucky that I'm able to say this. I say it exactly like I would in class. Now, students in our classes, this semester, people have been getting 80s, 90s, and 100s, meaning full credit, right? If you get an 80 on a presentation, it's usually only like something's missing, like there was no introduction, or there was no conclusion, or you was too fast, or you didn't make any sense. It's usually something major that can be easily corrected. And then I send you a personal note. Otherwise, I just make notes in the comments section. And then I hope you find your grades wherever students find their grades. So you get an 80 or 90 or 100. It's very hard to get fail one of my classes or fail a speech unless you just don't do it. Then that's the only way. I am so appreciative of all your efforts. How weird this is to do this in a video camera, but you are developing your oral communication skills. The body of work is valuable. And I could see from the introductions to the in the new speeches, students starting to feel more familiar with this format, a little bit more relaxed. And you will see it in the information speeches, a little bit more relaxed. And you will say, oh, I know Hannah. Oh, I know Joe. Oh, I know this one. Oh, I know Joyce. I saw her before. Hey, here she is again. So it's amazing how we can build community even though we are distant from each other. So do leave comments. I know some people, just like in class, some students would never make a comment and others always make a comment. So if you are so inspired to, please send a comment to you. I know you're doing the critiques in the journals, but those are private. And I noticed so many students writing really positive things about their peers, and then they didn't leave a comment on their speech. So I'd like to say, if you're thinking enough of your peers to write nice things in positive, constructive words in the critique, go back. You can go back into the week before, look up the student and make a comment there. And hopefully by the end of the semester, any one person can look at all their presentations and maybe they can start seeing their comments. It just makes you feel not so alone. And I noticed that in the critiques, people wrote some really, really great things about each other. But I don't share those, so you have to share them. All right, so information, it's up to you. You're teaching us something. You have 4 to 7 minutes. And within the 7 minutes, you should try to get into that 7 minutes. That calls economy of words. Good luck. I know it's going to be fabulous, and I will probably see most of your speeches in by the weekend, which is fine. It really is. I know you all have time management. Today is Columbus Day. That's another story all in that. If anyone wants to talk about the story of Christopher Columbus, knock yourself out, because that's a complicated hot mess. We think Donald Trump's a hot mess. Oh, we've had other examples of this in history. Yowza. But I love my Italian friends. I wouldn't want to take the day away from them, because they enjoy the feeling that someone from their culture is being supported, even if it's getting more confusing to live on this planet, isn't it? The more we know, the better we should be doing, though, just like Maya Angelou said. So thank you for listening. I hope all is good. I'm in my office. I'm going home soon. And I hope you're home, too. All right. Take care. Bye-bye.